Okay, so first thing that we are going to discuss about is update. Okay, how do we update the data? To update records within Salesforce, what you need is you need a reference for those records. Okay, while I'm doing an import, at that time I simply have a few records and I want them to be in the, I want to put them inside Salesforce, right? Now the data which was not there in Salesforce is being created. Okay, when I do an export in that, what happens, the data which is in Salesforce is being taken out. But in update, what needs to be done, I have a data in the spreadsheet and I have data within Salesforce and I want to update the records existing, already existing in the Salesforce. So for that reason I need to supply some reference, right? That okay, go and edit this record. Which record? It needs to understand, right? So that should be very clearly mentioned in the spreadsheet, okay? Or a primary key kind of a concept. So there has to be a unique identifier which should distinguish between records so that the wrong record does not get updated, okay? So how do we do that? We have a field called ID. There's a field called ID. Whenever you create a record, ID is generated automatically by Salesforce for every record. Whatever objects you have seen, every object has an ID field and this ID is generated. Okay. So just give me a minute. So when we want to do update, we'll have to consider the ID field for referencing the right record. Okay, so where do we get the values of the ID field? Firstly, let's log in into the data loader. Shilpa, can you put the password and the security token in the chat window again? Security token you can take from yesterday's email. Security token, are you fetching it, Shilpa? Okay, thank you. Okay. So let me log in into this. Now before you can update some data, let's say you have 4 or 5 records to be updated, you need to know the IDs of those records. Getting my point? So you need to have the IDs of those records. If you do not have IDs, then you cannot update the records. Alright, so let's do you know, an example and see how do we generally update the records. So before I can update the record, I have to get the IDs. IDs are within Salesforce. So before I can update the data, I'll have to take out the IDs from Salesforce. How will I take out the IDs? Export. Okay. So first of all, let's do an export. Let's say export of accounts. And I say export for update. Okay. Now for any object, you will see there is this field called ID. Have to make sure, because this is the identifier. This has to be taken out. Then let me copy name and phone, fax, industry, website also I'll take. Okay, so these fields we will need to export. Click on finish. Yes, export is the simple export that we did yesterday. Okay, now go open your Excel spreadsheet. Open the file that you have exported. Okay, so here is the file. All right. So this is one way. The other way of doing is, I mean, this is where I have taken out the export. The other thing is when you do an insert, I told you that you get log files, right? The error and success log files. The success log files will have all the records which got created. See, the success log files have all the records which got created, which is the one that we did yesterday, 27th. Let's say any success log file I'll take. So the success log files always contain the record IDs. Got it? So you can take the IDs from here also, and the other option is you can export the data. Alright. So if you imported some data yesterday and today you realize that you need to update something on that, you can always go to the success log file as well. Okay, because that also contains the IDs. Alright, so that thing is done. Now make the changes wherever you want to make the changes. Let's say United Oil and Gas. I don't want the website to look like this. I want the website to look like this. HTTP dot I want to remove. Make change here. Again, Here I see this HTTP thing is there. Let me remove it. Here also we see the same thing. Okay. Let's say this is what we have updated. Alright. Anything else if you want to update, we can do that. IBM India. So changes whatever changes you want to make, you make the changes, update the file, save it back. So this is already in CSV format, you just have to save it. Fine. Now the other thing that you might have noticed that this file has the So what you have noticed is this file has IDs, right? So this ID will be the identifier. This will help data loader understand that which record it is referring to, and then it will go to that particular record. See, name cannot be identifier because names can be duplicated. So we needed a solid identifier. So ID is an identifier, it's completely unique. So it will take it to that record, and then data loader will simply see what changes are there between the records data in the file and the data in the Salesforce, and it will make the changes. Okay. So that's fine then. Now let me go to the data loader. Now we'll do the update. Now all the same stuff. Okay. It does not show that file means I need to save it again. The format might not be the right one. Have this file save as. Okay. So you have to save it as comma separated. It has come as tab delimited. Go to desktop, save it as comma delimited. Fine, that's it. If it is not shown in that list when you try to browse the file from data loader, you don't see that file, which means it is not in comma delimited format. So it's pretty simple. Come here and save as the comma delimited format. So where is my data loader? Here it is. File is ready. Yes. Okay. Now browse the file. This is my file extract for update. Okay. Go to next. Map the fields. So we just have to map the fields. Everything is similar to what we have done earlier. Now from here on it's all same. Name field is here. industry is here, phone is here, website is here. Okay, okay. So you are you sure you want to proceed? Yes. 16 successful updates. Okay. All the records got updated. See, IBM name changed, Dell name changed, alert name changed, all the record name changed. Websites have got updated. Item updated. Got this? So that ID has to be supplied. That's the only thing that is different between an insert and an update. Nothing else. Okay. Now the same way, the next thing that we are going to talk about is a delete operation, mass delete. So when I say a mass delete, there again we have to supply a CSV file. The CSV file should contain the ID only. Okay, when you are trying to do a data delete through data loader, your CSV file should have IDs. Record IDs are to be supplied. Okay. Let's say okay. Here I have these records, right? Let's say I want to delete these three records. So I have to take the IDs of these records. Now I already have this in my CSV, so I'll take it. And create a new file. Put the IDs here. So that's it. I mean, you have to tell Salesforce that these are the records that I want to delete. How will you tell? With the IDs. That's it. In delete, you don't have to do anything. Save it. Save as, and then go ahead and click on. Okay. First of all, save the file. On desktop, we'll save it. Right. Delete file, comma delimited. Click on save. Done. Now just go to data loader, click on delete, accounts, browse the file, delete file, go to next. Your operation will contain three records. Okay, again map the ID with the ID. So in delete operation you just have one field to map, that's delete. Hey, that's ID. See, no other field needs to be mapped, because if you supply the ID, that's more than enough. Anyhow, it just has to go and delete the record. Click on OK. Next. Where do you want the log files to be stored? Finish. Okay. So it just gives you warning. The number of records allowed in a recycle bin is limited. The action you are about to take may cause irreversible data loss to records. That's fine. It just gives you a warning. Are you sure you want to delete? Yes. There are successful, three successful deletes. These three items got deleted. So those three records now got deleted. Alright. So now let me go and check on the Salesforce account. Let me log in into the Salesforce account and see the records have been updated and deleted. So if I go to accounts, see whatever changes I made to this record, it is visible here. Okay. Then if you go to the home page and then you click on recycle bin, you will see the records that you just deleted. So there's a recycle bin. The data that you delete is generally moved to the recycle bin. Okay. So it's not that it gets deleted permanently. All right. So you have that option of going back to this and then undelete it. So if you feel that, okay, fine, by mistake you deleted this record, just come to recycle bin and click on undelete. It will restore those records. Like we have our recycle bin in the operating system, Windows file you delete and then you can go to the recycle bin. Same concept. So now your records have been restored. Clear? So delete is one thing. Now this mass delete, as we saw, is an option from data loader. You can also do the mass delete right from this login, from your Salesforce account login. Okay, there is an option of deleting mass records. Why we need that other option of mass delete? Because when you have to delete it from data loader, you can just supply the ID. But sometimes it happens that you just want to check a few records and then delete them. You don't remember the IDs and all that stuff, or you don't know the exact IDs and all. You just want to see a few records and figure out whether you want to keep those or not and delete it quickly. So there's a mass delete option available here. You just have to go to setup and then go to data management and then go to mass delete records. Okay. But mass delete of records happens for only these objects. Okay. You cannot delete any other object using that. Like opportunities, you can delete, cannot delete from here. So that sort of things. Okay. So for if you want to delete any other object, then you have to take help of data loader. But some things like accounts, you can delete from here. Okay. Now mass delete of accounts, this is pretty simple. You can put any criteria if you have, or straight away click on search. Will show all the records. If you had put a criteria, it would have shown you only the records with that criteria. And then you can select the ones that you want to delete. Let's say I want to delete this, this, or I want to delete this one, and this, these four records. I want to delete. Select it and click on delete. So this is one more mass delete option. When it is deleted, it will go to recycle bin. However, when you are doing a mass delete from here, you have an option of clicking on permanently delete. If you select this one, when this option is selected, you cannot restore deleted records from the recycle bin. Okay. So sometimes it happens that you are very, very sure that you won't, do not want to restore those records. It was by mistake entered and all. So you just delete the records and select this option. Otherwise, the records will be moved into the recycle bin. Clear on that? Now go to the recycle bin and check the records again. Yeah, these records have been moved to recycle bin. If you don't want it in recycle bin, you can just save to your recycle bin. Or you can just undelete. Clear on the mass delete thing? Now the other thing that we are going to talk about is mass transfer. So mass transfer is what, as I told you, changing the owner of the records, transferring it from one owner to the other owner. So in a way that is update only. In a way mass transfer is a kind of update, data update, right? So you can do transfer using the update operation also, but it will be a little difficult for you. Why it will be difficult? That again you have to, you know, take out the IDs, and then you'll have to supply the IDs of the users. Okay, so that becomes a little challenging. So we have a mass transfer option available here under setup menu. You can go to setup, data management, mass transfer records. Click on transfer accounts, transfer from and transfer to, which user you want to transfer from and which user you want to transfer to. Okay, that needs to be defined, and again the same kind of option you will have. Click on find. Let's say I want to transfer to because I do not have more users here. So this is it. Same way, just select the records. In current org, I just have, you know, I don't have more users. I think I have, let's say this is the guy. Okay, so from Shilpa, if I want to transfer to James, I can do that. Okay, select the records and transfer it to that particular owner. So that will make things simpler. Got it? So I can select all the records and then transfer. So transferring data and mass delete of data becomes a little simpler with this data management option, because you need to supply IDs where you are dealing with data loader. You do not have this UI kind of thing available there. Okay. Got it? So now we understand how to do updates, mass deletes and mass transfers, right? The next thing that we will talk about is the storage usage. The next is storage usage. Storage usage you will find under data management only, setup data management. There's this option of storage usage. Okay, this gives you a complete details of the storage of the files and the data. Salesforce provides you two types of storage. It provides you data storage space. Currently that is 5 MB per developer org, and it gives you file storage. File storage is where you can save your files, documents and all that. Some images that you want to store, or some PDFs, some agreements, spreadsheets, Word documents, whatever. So that those files can be stored, and the data storage is allowed for that. Currently it is 20 MB, currently for developer edition I'm talking about. For general editions, commonly it is data storage is 1 GB and file storage is 10 GB. So this is the common thing. However, it increases based on how many licenses you have purchased, and you also have that option of purchasing extra storage space. So that option is available. So let's look into this storage usage thing. How much data storage I have? 5 MB. Out of that, how much has been used? What is the percentage used? File storage, how much I have? 20 MB. Out of that, 40 KB has been used. 0%. 40 KB is used, which is almost 0%. Which object is using how much of storage? how many records in which object, what is the storage it has, you know, taken, and what is the percentage. Okay, now this helps you understand in a way that which object is occupying maximum space. Sometimes you are putting the data into the system continuously, and you are almost about to reach your storage limit. Now you want to figure out which object is occupying more space so that I can empty it. Okay, sometimes you will realize that okay, fine, one of the objects has a lot of useless data which is not required, and there is a scope of cleaning that object and removing a lot of records. That will make life easier for the users as well as free up some space. So in that case, you can just look into this, that okay, which object is occupying maximum space, and is there a scope of reducing that or not, the size of that object. And the same way it goes for the files, which file is occupying more space and all that stuff, how many photos, how many documents, then top users by data storage, which all users have the maximum data storage in the system, and top users by file storage, which users have the maximum file storage in the system. So which users are utilizing most of the system space, so that you can again try to free it up from that point of view. Maybe go back to that user and say that okay, fine, you remove some of the data or archive some of the things, that sort of thing. Fine, get clear on this. Tell me if you have any question or doubt here. Simple. Right. So if you understand this part, then we are okay with our data management thing. Okay. Okay, data management we understand. Now the next thing that we have to talk about is the access and permissions. Now once you have put the data into the system, and once you have your application there and there is data inside this, the next thing that is of your concern is, will everyone have the same level of access? Does everyone in the company need same access? No. Some people need more access, some of them need lesser access, right? Some people you don't want to delete the data, some people you don't want to be able to edit the data, some of them should not be able to create the data. So we need to control the access and permissions. Okay. So that is the next thing that we are going to talk about. How do we do that? So before we get into access and permission, first thing that we have to understand is users. So for every person who you want to have a login ID and password, who should be able to log in into Salesforce, you need to create a user in Salesforce. Okay. Where do we create the user? Go to setup, under manage users, users. Okay. You can click on this. This will show you a list of all the users which are there currently. For every user, again, you have to understand that you have to have licenses, enough licenses to create the users. If you have 10 licenses, you can just create 10 users. Got that, right? So depending on how many licenses you have, you'll be able to create the users. Again, the other day I told you that there are different types of licenses. Like I was telling you, there is a Salesforce license, and then there is a, what is the other license that we talked about? Apart from Salesforce, there is one more license I told you guys. What was that? Platform. Again, there can be a chatter free license. There is another license called chatter free. Okay, so chatter free is basically only for using this. So a user who has a chatter free license can only use the chatter functionality. Chatter is it's a communicator kind of a thing. So you can use this chatter to communicate within your organization. So you see, there is a chat window, and there is a place where you can post your things and then you can share with everyone. Okay, so Salesforce by default provides a lot of free licenses for this. Like for chatter free, I think they provide 500 free licenses for developer edition also. On any other thing, they provide a lot of free licenses for chatter free. Okay, this chatter free licenses only for using chatter. So let's say in your company there are 5 people who work on Salesforce, but you want to collaborate with all other people as well who are not using Salesforce. So you can use these chatter free licenses. You can create licenses for all those people in your company using these chatter free licenses. It is not going to cost you anything, and you can stay connected to those people using this thing. Okay, so whatever you share here, the files you want to share, any status update you want to share, they will be able to see. Got it? So like any other, think of it as an internal social media for a company, right? So small Facebook or a communicator where you can communicate with people who are online. That is, right? So that thing is there. Now the next, what we have to do is, learn how to create a user. Create a user, go to setup, manage users, click on users, okay, and then you can simply click on new user. When you click on user, see, it asks you for the license, which license you want to use. These are the licenses which have been provided on a developer edition. Out of all these licenses, Salesforce license is the one which is useful. But they just provide 2 Salesforce licenses with developer edition, so it is not here. Okay. And and other licenses are not of that much use for chatter free. Create a chatter free user. So this way you can create a user, put the first name, last name, alias and all that stuff. Create the user. Got that thing? Clear on that, how to create a user. Now once you've created a user, the next thing is, how do you control the permissions for that user? How do you control the permissions for the user? It's very simple. There is a concept called profile. What is a profile? Profile is set of permissions. Okay, so profile is a collection of permissions or set of permissions. This profile is assigned to the user. Okay, so the user, if you noticed while we are creating a new user, it asked you for a profile, right? So what all permissions the user will have depends on the profile that the user has got. Got it? Now let's say you have a profile for sales people, call it sales profile, and then you have a marketing profile. And then you have a customer support profile. Okay, so you will put all the permissions which are required by the sales team in this profile. You will put all the permissions required by the marketing team in this profile, and the profiles required by customer support team in the profile called customer support profile. So that is how you are actually going to do this. Okay, And the reason why we put permissions on in the profile and then assign the profile to users is reusability. So if there are 20 people who need same kind of permission, instead of I giving permissions to each one of them individually, I can simply create a profile and put all the permissions in that profile and assign the same profile to 20 people. So controlling will become easier for me. Definitely in a company, everyone does not need a unique set of permissions, right? There is a group which needs same kind of permissions. So instead of, you know, I going and giving permission to 100 people one by one, I can just create a profile and give it to everyone. Next time I want to make change again, I do not have to go and make changes on 100 people. I just need to make change in the profile. So that is the reason why they have created this concept of profile. Okay. So where do you see the profiles? You can go and see the profile under setup, manage users, profiles. This is where you see the profiles. So here is the list of profiles. These are the profiles which have been provided by Salesforce. So these are standard profiles. You have standard profiles and then you have custom profiles. We have standard profiles and we have custom profiles. Okay. So standard profile is what? What is standard profile? Standard profile is basically the ones which have been provided by Salesforce. Custom profile is the ones are the ones which we create. Okay. So sometimes you will be okay to use the standard profiles because the requirement that you have exactly matches with the kind of profile that they have provided. You use the standard profile. So if your users need the permissions which are already there in one of these, you can use that standard profile, right? If my users need something which does not match any of these profiles, then I can simply go and create a new profile. I do have the option of creating a new profile, or you can edit the existing profiles as well. In case you feel like, okay, fine, I just need to make small changes in the profile and that will resolve the issue for you, you can just go ahead and make changes in the existing profile also. However, your standard profiles do not allow you to make changes to everything. There are very small changes that you can make in standard profile. Okay. You cannot change everything. That is the reason why we need to take help of custom profiles whenever required. All right. So now on profiles, what permissions are controlled on the profile? Let's understand that. On the profiles we have on the profiles we have the apps. Which all apps will be visible to the user is defined on the profile of the user. Okay. Tabs. Which all tabs a user will see, that also depends on the profile. So that is also defined on the profile. Object permissions. So object permissions have a few options: read, create, edit, delete. Read, create, edit, delete. So object means the database tables. So on an object, whether the user will have a read access or a create access, edit access or delete access, that also depends on the profile. That is also defined on the profile of the user. Okay. So some users, you just want them to see the data. Some of them should not even see the data. Some users should have access to see the data. Some should be able to create new records. Some of them should be able to delete, right? So this level of permissions need to be controlled on the profile for end users. So these permissions are controlled here. Apart from that, there is one more thing which is called field level security. Field level security means if there are a few fields in an object, let's say you have given a read permission to the users, okay, there are certain group of users who has the read permission, so they will see all the data in that object. However, there can be one or two confidential fields, let's say the ones which contain the SSN, social security number. Now, if that is a confidential field and you don't want the users to see that, you can hide that from a profile, the fields. Okay, so sometimes like an email ID can be a confidential field, you don't want everyone to see that. or any other field. That, so those fields can be hidden from the users. That is also done through the profile thing. Okay. So now let me just go and click on any of these profiles and see how it works. Okay, there's this profile called standard user. Let me go and click on edit. Okay, so if you click on edit, this will show you a long list of permissions and, you know, things which are there in this profile. So first is the app settings, which all apps are visible to this standard user, people with this standard user profile, these apps. You have that option of controlling if you don't want them to see a few apps. If you just want them to see the sales and marketing app, remove everything else from here. Okay. So as a system administrator, you can do this. So if you are told that, okay, people with the standard user profile, this is a profile, right? People with this profile should not see all the apps. They should only see marketing and sales app. Or they should not even see the sales app. They should only see the marketing app. That way, if you want to give access to more apps, warehouse app they should see, support app they should see, you can allow access to this. Clear on this? Same way tabs. If you don't want the users to see some of the tabs, you can just go and make them tab hidden. Hide those tabs. Campaigns, now the users with this profile will not see this tab. It will only affect the people who have been assigned this profile, the one that I'm editing. Okay. So we have the app setting, we have the tab setting, we have object permissions. Apart from that, there are a few admin permissions and a few general user permissions. Okay. So these are the things which are controlled on a profile. The apps should be visible to the profile, the tabs should be visible to the profile. Object permissions, if you scroll down, you will see the object permission. See, all the objects are listed and you have that option of checking read, create, edit, delete. Sometimes you will not select any one of these, which will mean this object is not visible to this user at all. Like venues, not visible at all. Okay, admin permissions and general user permissions. Now what you see here is that the first two I am able to edit. I am able to edit the app setting, I am able to edit tab setting, but after this everything is grayed out. Admin permission I cannot edit. Do you see I have an option of editing mode? General user permission I cannot edit. Do I have an option of editing mode? Object permissions I cannot edit. Do I have an option of editing mode? Right? Which means that in standard profile you cannot edit this one and object permissions. So simple thing is, as I told you earlier, that standard profile you cannot make changes on everything. So you cannot edit object permissions, admin permissions and general user permissions. Standard profile. So these three things you cannot edit in standard profiles. You cannot edit object permissions, admin permissions, and general user permissions on the standard profile. Okay, clear on this? So in case you wanted a few changes on these of these things, then the other option you have is go ahead and create a custom profile. Are you clear with the profile concept? Anyone has a question here? Okay, so we have understood about profile. There are a few more concepts on this related to the access and permissions. So there is another thing which is called a permission set, which is combined with the profile to define certain exceptions. We'll talk about permission sets. Then there is another thing called sharing settings, which is okay. So as I told you that this is what we have discussed on the profile. So profile is one aspect. There are more things. One is permission set, which needs to be combined with the profile to define certain exceptions. So we'll talk about that. Similar to profile, but it's used mostly for defining exceptions. Another thing is sharing settings. So what we have not discussed in this profile section as of now is the data access. Currently, if I'm talking about object, I'm talking about the entire object. But how about I don't want Sesha to see my data? He should see accounts. I will also see accounts. Both of us will have access to accounts, but I don't want him to see my data and he does not want me to see his data. Got that? So that is the sharing setting. So that is again something that we are going to discuss in our next session. Fine. So we'll talk further on this profiles thing, sorry, access and permission things with the help of permission sets and sharing settings. Okay. So that's fine. Then let's continue our discussion on the same thing in our next session. All right. Okay then, thank you for